Another fucking musical. Last time I did a musical on this show, things got a little frisky, a little out of control. My neighbors have forbidden me to go out on the front porch again. But that's okay, because best to my knowledge, no one in this film performs a song in the nude.
And thank fucking Christ, because the movie we're looking at today is Superman, the 1975 musical. Haven't heard of this little made-for-TV gem?
Oh, come on! It's based on the Broadway play! What? Never heard of the Broadway play?
In 1966, the Superman musical, It's a Bird, It's a Plane, It's Superman, debuted to a Broadway audience of hundreds by the month. Despite being nominated for 3 Grammy Awards, the Superman Broadway musical closed its doors after only 3 months and 129 performances, but that never stopped it from returning in various stage revivals, and none was probably more notorious than its 1975 incarnation as a made-for-TV movie by ABC Television under their Wide World of Entertainment program. The special probably had fewer viewers than a single one of its Broadway performances, plus it fell victim to scathing, venomous reviews from the critics.
So here's another scathing, venomous review from a critic.
Good God, already this movie looks like it's gonna have more corpses than Nudist Colony of the Dead. What's with this coloring book title card? Even the Superman game for the NES had a livelier title card than this.
Even this box cover has more personality than the fucking movie.
Is that Superman or Freddie Mercury? I can't tell if this movie is supposed to be taking place in Metropolis or inside Vincent D'Onofrio's head from The Cell.
Since playbills couldn't be mailed to our houses for us, the movie decides to stick all of its cast information at the beginning of the movie.
Starring as Max Mencken, Kenneth Mars, deceitful glamour boy columnist for the Metropolis Daily Planet.
I hate Superman.
You know who else hates Superman? The writers of this fucking movie!
It's nice to know that 35 years before The Fourth Kind, movies were still shooting themselves in the foot by having the cast introduce themselves to us.
And as Sidney Carleton, Loretta Swick as Dr. Abner Sedgwick, David Wayne.
Tonight's special guest star, Lorne Greene.
It's time to get a good look at Superman. Okay, is he going to be the George Reeves-style Superman? Or Christopher Reeve? Or Brandon Routh?
And introducing David Wilson as Clark Kent, meek and mild-mannered reporter for the Daily Planet.
This is our star. This guy?
He looks like Dr. Earhart. Well, does he fare any better as Superman?
Hi there, America, and friendly nations everywhere. Glad we could get together.
No, he still sucks, but at least the movie gave him the extra power of bad editing. The movie explains the origin story of Superman the same way you'd expect to hear the backstory of a killer Venus flytrap.
Look, Mother. One innocent babe.
We've always wanted one of those.
Then by golly, we'll adopt them.
You know, you might want to check inside that rocket first, because just going by the word babe, there's a good chance that it could either be a pig or John Goodman.
In case you still don't know who Superman is, don't worry, because the cast of extras comes along to fucking sing about him. I'm having a hard time ignoring the backgrounds here. It's like a kindergarten class put together their own production of Dick Tracy. And speaking of Dick Tracy, check out this gang of big boy caprices the movie has assembled together.
I pledge allegiance to the mobs of the United Hoods of the Underworld. One family, all invisible, with larceny and rub-outs for all.
Wow, why don't you just put him in a sweatsuit and dunk him in marinara sauce? Oh, please tell me there's a Godfather reference.
There's somebody we gotta take out. Somebody's given crime a very bad name.
Marlon Brando?
No, you can't bump off Marlon Brando. He hasn't made Island of Dr. Moreau yet. In case you're wondering, the gangsters do get their own song.
We woke up this morning,
trust me, after the first song in this movie, you're better off not hearing the actual lyrics.
He brings the orphans Christmas turkey.
Christmas turkey, yes he does, yes he does.
He flew my asthmatic son to Albuquerque.
Yes, brilliant idea. Help the kid with asthma by carrying him 10 miles up into the fucking sky.
Stay tuned for Chapter 2, Merchant of Doom.
Nope.
Back at the Daily Planet, really? Could this look any more like a fucking sitcom?
I want all the news that's fit to print, and I want it now. Get that story.
Jesus, getting in touch with your inner Dan O'Herlihy there, Perry? Not only does the look of this sequence seem like something out of the Duck Factory, but even the dialogue is pure sitcom material.
Gee, Lois, you look nifty today.
Hmm? Oh, Clark, have you been there all along?
Yeah, for 4 hours. Hey,
take a gander at this lead item for my column, Max Mencken's Metropolis.
You stood me up last night. Why should I?
Because I'm gorgeous. But Scarlet Kate Schlemiel with an S on his chest.
It doesn't stay like a sitcom for long, though, because, of course, what's 5 minutes in this movie without a fucking song?
A wasted life is all I've got with Superman.
The villain is a mad scientist named Dr. Sedgwick, who comes into the Daily Planet to find out more information about Superman.
It's all part of my master plan to bring him down. Oh, he's a great hero now, but the higher he flies, the further he has to fall.
Yeah, whatever, Gore Vidal. All I know is that you're not Lex Luthor, so I really don't care.
Also, he doesn't tell us his evil plan, he sings it. Way to make me not pay attention to your fucking plot, movie!
What is the one terrible thing that Dr. Sedgwick will have before he dies?
Huh. Looks like the last thing he did was drinking out of that cup, because I'm pretty sure this actor just died. And this isn't the only time he looks like he's gonna drop dead right on camera.
Well, as we say in academia, you can't win them all.
Oh, but you haven't won any.
Keep going, movie. His soul is still dancing.
Oh well, at least in Chapter 3, we'll have Richard Pryor as our comic relief. Dr. Sedgwick's plan is to kill Superman with the use of a super powerful death ray.
Isn't it always?
Well, here's the problem. They're just busy in the other room shooting an episode of the Batman series. When the death ray doesn't work, Dr. Sedgwick joins forces with Daily Planet reporter Max Mencken, who hates Superman. For some reason. Maybe Superman out-male chauvinist Mencken. I don't know.
Oh, poor Sidney.
Hey, sweetheart. How about a late date tonight? I'll be through after midnight. Just call me Cinderella.
Fuck, is this Mad Men the musical all of a sudden?
You know, you're really quite a dish. Yeah, what a guy. Mike Call, delish.
Yep, that's exactly what it is.
It doesn't help, too, that Lois Lane in this movie feels more like Laura Petrie from the Dick Van Dyke Show.
Oh, that's the spirit, Sidney. Oh.
Well, that brings us to the end of Chapter 4, thank God.
Stay tuned for Chapter 5, The Net Titans. Chapter 5, The Net Titans.
I know!
We pick up with Max Mencken and Dr. Sedgwick elaborating on their master plan.
I mean to say that Superman would destroy himself.
Ah, I see. You mean that Superman would destroy himself.
I mean that Superman would destroy himself.
I would call the dialogue repetitive, but that'd be hypocritical of me, because this review is just me coming up with different ways in saying that this movie's a piece of shit.
While Mencken and Sedgwick are trying to out-dialogue each other on the same fucking lines, let's see what the Rocky and Muggsy group is up to.
You think you got problems? I can't even pronounce it.
What?
Invulnerable.
My God, they're slowly transforming from mobsters into the tramps!
Meanwhile, Clark Kent is having some troubles of his own, mainly in figuring out how to keep the world's largest fedora on top of the world's largest head.
Will Clark Kent find happiness with a new love? Stay tuned for Chapter 6. Clark Kent finds happiness.
Whoa! Spoiler alert, movie!
Well, let's hope that Chapter 6 here adds more to the story.
Meanwhile...
You mean Superman would destroy himself.
God damn it, that isn't a fucking joke! That's just the plot point they keep repeating!
Actually, they do elaborate on their plan in quite possibly the most homoerotic duet next to Wham!
You got what I need, baby. You got it and how.
It's like watching Ron Burgundy hit on Henry Gibson.
Being kissed in the office has given Clark enough steel balls to finally ask out Lois, which actually works, making the two of them an item. Except for the fact that Lois still daydreams about one day being with Superman.
And candlelight on every anniversary. It's what I've always wanted. Somewhere that's green.
The plan of Dr. Sedgwick and Max is to have Superman appear at a public function while a bomb is set off at City Hall.
Well, Mr. Mencken, what do you make of this City Hall explosion?
Well, it exploded.
It's always weird seeing Bill O'Reilly's early work.
When Superman is unavailable to save City Hall, he is ousted by the Metropolis citizens and run out of town.
Stay tuned for Chapter 9. Get lost, Superman.
Yes, movie, please, please, get lost.
Superman slash Clark is now in a funk as his alter ego has been shattered and no one in the city loves him anymore. Yes, Superman goes emo in this movie, and he sings about it too.
As if we don't already have enough fucking songs with someone singing about how they are or aren't Superman.
And it does this same type of song, not once, but twice.
Don't they know the strongest man can cry?
This movie is one step closer to turning into a fucking Five for Fighting song. And that, I will not fucking tolerate.
But not even all of that could stop Lois Lane from continuing to sing about her love for Superman.
What I've always wanted, just to be a wife, that corny life.
Well, that's sad. Even the background music has given up on this movie.
Lois gets abducted by Dion and the Belmonts, but luckily Loretta Swit is here to sing us another song, this time with background music.
I don't care.
Superman continues on his funk, even attempting to drown himself in the river by tying himself to an anchor, until he comes across two people who still believe in him. Hippies!
Yes! The hippies saved Metropolis!
By telling him that some of the greatest men in history are freaks like Superman, it cheers him up.
Christopher Columbus. Now, he was such a freak that they had to send him off on a boat.
That's right. And Honest Abe Lincoln. Hey, freeing the brothers was the freakiest thing of the 1800s.
So that's how you get Superman his mojo back? By reminding him of slavery?
Forget it, Superman. You just do your thing.
Right arm. Lois is in danger. I'm gonna split.
Oh, he's gotta hurry. His spider sense is tingling.
Superman makes it to the villain's hideout where only one solution will solve everything. Dance fighting! And again, complete with Batman-style choreography.
I think you know exactly where I'm going with this. Superman. Superman. Fucking Superman. Superman saves the day, and the villains... Actually, that'd be too dark, so they explain away the villain's fate by saying the explosion caused them to come down with amnesia, so they can't remember that they were once evil. I would call this a total fucking embarrassment, but the one nice thing I can say about it is that at least it doesn't have John Cryer in it.
But I, for one, am fucking pissed off that not once in this movie did I feel like dancing on the porch.
Accusations.
A world of cheap sensations. A world with no foundation. That's all.
I am Superman!
You may ask, why do I want to rule the world? In order to obliterate Sweden.